This episode is brought to you by Squarespace. All right, you guys, we just got back home from a long day of filming here in the city. We were shooting some street photography and whatnot, but while I was out there, I got this random idea to do a video on how to set up any camera for street photography. Now, there's really no one way to do street photography, and same goes for setting up your camera. You know, one way of setting up a camera isn't gonna cover all, but I do personally feel like there are a couple of settings that I always fall back to, and that's what I wanna share in this video. They've been working for me for the last couple of years, and I hope that, you know, by the end of this episode, it can help you out. Now, as most of you guys know already, I do shoot digital cameras, but for the most part, a lot of my street photography work is done on film. And so not only are we gonna talk about, you know, how I set up my point and shoot film cameras, as well as kind of like my Fuji mirrorless cameras, but we're also going to be talking about how I set up my film cameras for street photography. So without further ado, guys, grab your cameras, maybe grab a notebook if you want to, but here is how I set up my cameras for street photography. All right, so the first thing that I want to talk about is setting up a point and shoot film camera or any kind of digital camera for street photography. Now, these two are pretty much the cameras that I use when I am shooting digital for street photography. I have a Ricoh GR3 right here, which is a great little point and shoot, as well as this one right here. This is a Fuji xpro 2 with a 23mm f2 lens. And so if you guys have any of these cameras, what I'm about to talk about is going to transfer very, very easily to you. Now, even if you don't have these cameras right here in front of me or anything similar, it all really applies the same. All right, so let's start out with my most important variable. Anytime I am out shooting street photography and there's daylight out, even if it's a little bit cloudy, but for the most part there is sun outside, my ISO, especially on digital cameras, is always going to stay at 800 or 1600. ISO plays a huge role in what apertures and shutter combinations you use throughout the day in changing, you know, scenery, different lighting situations and conditions. All that means is with a high ISO, you're gonna be forced to stop your lens down to f8 to f16, which is going to give you more depth in your image. Same goes for shutter speed. When you're shooting at a high f-stop, your camera automatically is going to need to have a faster shutter speed to compensate because it's very sensitive already at 800 ISO. So a faster shutter speed and a much more narrow aperture. When shooting with an xpro 2, I always make sure that my ISO is set to 800. And typically I'll leave it there throughout the entire day. I won't touch it one bit. But on the GR3, I like to shoot this anywhere between 1250 and 1600 ISO. Now, when I am shooting street photography, if I have the option to shoot in aperture priority, I will always choose that. And if you don't know what aperture priority is, basically your camera decides what the shutter speed will be. And the only thing that you control is your aperture. And this is great if you wanna have nice depth of field and you wanna use that for creative effect. The only risk though is that because your camera is going to set the shutter speed for you, you need to make sure again that you have a high enough ISO so that if you are shooting, for example, at like f8 or f16, your shutter speed doesn't drop to a value that runs the risk of you getting motion blur in your images. Now, with aperture priority, generally, depending on the situation, my range for most of the street photographs that I make is 5.6 to f16. The reason why I do this is because I use a technique called zone focusing. Now, zone focusing heavily relies on you using a much, much smaller aperture, like f8, f11, f16. If you ever look at your lens, matter of fact, on top of each of your manual focus lenses, you're gonna have a hyperfocal scale. And this hyperfocal scale is going to have mirrored aperture markings on each side. Now, when you focus your lens, there's going to be a value in between. So usually I'm pre-focused to about 1.2 meters. I believe that's 1.2 here. So let's say I'm at f8. You guys can see the aperture markings kind of mirrored here. All of that range in between f8 is going to be in reasonable focus. And there's a better explanation here on my channel. I will link that in this card above here. It's my tutorial on zone focusing. But again, folks, I always make sure I stick between 5.6 and f16. The benefit of doing this, again, folks, is zone focusing, basically predetermining your range of focus so you don't need to focus your camera anymore. Number two is also getting a lot more things in your frame more sharp. Again, with a larger aperture like 1.4, 1.8, you run the risk of having such a small range of focus that you may potentially get things out of focus if you're not just like focused to infinity. And number three, it's just a lot more forgiving. Even if you slightly miss focus because you are shooting at a much, you know, smaller aperture, you're going to have some wiggle room. And so, you know, if somebody's 5 feet away, but you focus at like 4.5 feet, as long as you're in that range of like f8, f16, they're still going to be in reasonable focus. Now, before we move on to some of the in-camera settings like my presets and picture profiles that I use, I want to give a huge thank you and shout out to our sponsor for this episode, the good folks over at Squarespace. Squarespace is your all-in-one platform to build a beautiful online presence and run your business. Now, you guys, as any type of creative, whether you are a photographer, videographer, photojournalist, I mean, I guess that is photographer, if you fall under any one of those categories, it is essential that moving forward in 2022, you have your own dedicated website. And if you're like me and you don't really know how to build a website, you are in luck, man. Squarespace makes it super easy with award-winning templates that always regularly get updated, so there's fresh ones on there all the time. You also have the option to have an e-commerce shop for print sales, merchandise, whatever you want. And my favorite feature, folks, is the dedicated portfolio pages. A place where you can send your clients rather than sending them over to your Instagram. So if you guys haven't already, man, head over to squarespace.com/kingjapes or enter promo code at kingjapes at checkout, and you guys can receive 10% off of your first purchase of a domain or a website. Huge thank you to Squarespace, man, for sponsoring this episode. Now, in terms of actual picture profiles, and okay, I think Fuji calls it film simulations. Let me see. Okay, yeah, Fuji calls it film simulations. So just to give you a quick heads up, on the xpro 2, the film simulation that I use the most is called Classic Chrome. This is the one that I just feel like, you know, looks most like film, has really nice colors, and there's little adjustments here and there. If you guys want, I can make a whole entire video going through my settings on the xpro 2. And on the Ricoh GR, I like to use the positive film preset. I think that's what it's called. Yeah, positive film preset. But anytime that I am shooting color, those are my go-to kind of, you know, presets in camera. But something that I want to talk about in particular with the GR3 is the black and white preset that I use on here. So there's a lot of black and white presets, but the one that I use the most is high contrast black and white. The reason why I use this is because most of the time when I am shooting with a digital camera, I like to play around with my exposure compensation. And most of the time I will basically completely black out the shadows and really only reserve the highlights. And you know, the effect you get from it is kind of this very moody, this high contrast scene looking thing. And it can create some really, really beautiful images, especially if you're shooting midday. And if you just go along with kind of how I set these digital cameras up and what we just talked about, high ISO, high aperture and whatnot, you can pretty much achieve these results yourself. But now I want to talk about setting up a film camera for street photography. This goes for both rangefinders as well as SLR cameras, but I will just be using the Leica here kind of as my example. So in terms of ISO, now, because film cameras can only have one ISO, that's not variable ISO like digital, most of the time I have to shoot whatever I have laying around. And most of the time it's 400 ISO. Now, 400 ISO is very middle ground. It's not going to do great in very, very dark scenes like the nighttime. And in some cases, it even struggles in overcast weather. But if I had a choice every single time I went out to shoot film, what ISO I would select, it would most likely be 800 ISO. And 800 ISO, again, is just kind of the perfect balance in my opinion. You can still shoot it at nighttime as long as you open up, and it works great during the daytime, overcast, somewhat cloudy weather. It's just very, very versatile. Now, when I'm shooting film, most of the time I am manual metering unless I'm shooting with a camera like the F3 that has aperture priority. But even though most of the time I am shooting manual on my film cameras, I try my best to still think in an aperture priority mindset. So I will always put more priority on the aperture than I will on a shutter speed. On my Leica, I will always have my lens, regardless of what aperture I'm at, pre-focus to 1.2 meters. 1.2 meters is 4 feet, and 4 feet is a little bit longer than the distance of from my shoulder to the fingertips. So about a foot longer than my arm's length. And the reason why I do this is because when I shoot film, most of the time I'm thinking in sunny 16. So if it's sunny outside, I am at F16 and I'm pre-focused to 1.2 meters. That means if somebody in front of me is at 4 feet away from me, which is again 1.2 meters, they are going to be in crisp focus. And again, folks, it all comes down to that hyperfocal scale. So in a nutshell, that's pretty much how I set up my film cameras for street photography. As you guys can see, it's very similar to what I do with a digital camera. The only real difference is that on a digital camera, it's a lot more automated. You have aperture priority built into a lot of these newer cameras. You also have a rear display, which is going to allow you to adjust exposure on the fly without really having to be troubled, because even if you are a stop or two off, most modern digital cameras can recover anything in post. But if there's one thing that I want you guys to take away from this episode, it's to closely watch your aperture. Your aperture is going to determine so many factors in your frame, from focusing all the way up to the depth of field in your image. As street photographers, a lot of the time we are trying to tell a story. And when you're telling a story, you need to be able to see all of the details in the frame. And one way that you can almost guarantee that all the details in the frame are gonna be in focus is to shoot with a higher f-stop number like f8 or f16. At these apertures, especially if you're using autofocus, it's really hard to mess up a photograph. And when you're out there shooting street photography and things are moving quick and maybe you don't have time to focus fast, it's always, always going to be a lot safer to shoot with a higher value f-stop than it is to shoot something like f2 or 1.4. So there you have it, you guys. That is how I set up my cameras for street photography. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let me know in the comment section down below what you guys do for your street photography. Are there any different settings or any different ways of looking at it that I may be missing out on? Comment those down below. I'm interested to hear what you guys have to say. But that's going to wrap it up for this episode, you guys. I'll see you in the next one. As always, we know it's a game. But for now, we're going to